So today I decided that we make a video, and by we I mean me, about some frequent accessibility questions I get asked from my students, friends, or I was about to say just people on the street, but like that would be really weird. So just students or like members of my Facebook and Discord accessibility groups, or you know, people from the from anywhere. Okay, so I have them printed and written on a piece of paper because I'm very old-fashioned. So yeah, I thought we'd just get started with that. So let's go. Let's start with the first question is, for ARIA, which attributes are absolutely critical for usability and which are just nice to have? So this is an interesting question. It really depends on your widget and what you're building. If you're building, for example, a hamburger menu, then the suggested, or actually the ARIA you need is going to be ARIA label if the button doesn't have a visible label. And ARIA expanded is also very, very important. So I have seen people using ARIA controls on it, which is, I mean, you know, I don't use ARIA controls because it's like useless. So it really, really depends on your widget. But I would say if the ARIA documentation suggests it, like 90% of the time, they're right. And not actually the ARIA documentation, but more likely the ARIA note, author's guides that I use, 1.1 and 1.2. So I would say depends on the widget, and also depends if the ARIA attributes are supported. So for example, ARIA controls and ARIA has pop-up are like, I don't really use them because I'm making another video for that, but yeah. But I think the one attribute I can think of off the top of my head, which is like nice to have, if used correctly, is going to be ARIA described by, because ARIA described by doesn't give the element a name, it just gives it a description. An accessible name is something really, really important, and every interactive element should have an accessible name. Whereas a description is like, you know, just an extra information. And if used correctly, ARIA described by must use a visible text on the screen inside to be referenced by the interactive element. So if you're using ARIA description by with no visible text on the screen, then you're doing it wrong. So screen reader users can actually access the text on the screen, but if you add it, but if you reference it to an element, it's going to be much easier for them. For example, let's say that you have a password field and the accessible name is password, and then beneath the field it says, you know, password must have 8 characters minimum, and then so the screen reader can just press the screen reader can press the down arrow key and the screen is going to read the text. But this is, you know, you have to make them do an extra tap, and it's not like the most user-friendly interface. That's why you add ARIA described by and you point into the description underneath the input. And so the screen reader is going to say password must have at least 8 characters. Okay, so yeah, ARIA described by if used correctly. This is my Star Trek mug. My husband got it for me because I love Star Trek. Okay, next question is, how can you make a site that works visually whilst also working well for those with disabilities? So one misconception about accessibility is that your site must be very ugly and you're not allowed to make it pretty with animations, videos, any sort of graphics. It must only be text, which is not true at all. As long as you have an alternative version of the animations, the videos, anything, and I'm not talking about click here to access the accessible version of this site because that's horrible. Don't do that. I'm talking about, let's say, for example, you have a very nice graphic. Well, add a no text to it. Or if the graphic is just for decoration, just have a no out, okay? Or use it as a background image in CSS. If you have a beautiful video, you know, add a transcript, not only transcribing what people are saying, but, you know, transcribing the visuals as well. For example, a person slays dragon or something like that, okay? So you can have, basically, you can have any website you want and you can make it accessible. And, you know, if someone is able to see, they're not gonna know, okay, so all of these interactive elements have a name. If someone is using a screen reader, then it's gonna be awesome for them, okay? So one doesn't exclude the other, you know. That's the thing, it's a big misconception. Okay, next question is details about specifications and details about mobile testing. So about the specifications, like a whole novel can be written about them, but it's very important that you follow the HTML spec, and then on top of that comes the ARIA spec, and then the two of them are married to the WGAC, so basically make sure you write semantic and HTML that complies, actually conforms to the standards, okay? Because one time, I can give you an example, one time I had a span, I had a div inside a span, okay? And I thought, well, I can do that because both the span and the div, they have no accessible name, okay? They are just generic elements. So it doesn't matter, but someone pointed out to me that this is wrong. And I'm like, well, if they don't have an accessible name, how is that wrong? Actually, if you go into the HTML specification, there are difference between flow content and I think section content or something like that. Basically, you're not allowed to nest block elements inside inline elements. And since the span was an inline element, the div, it was working great. There was almost no difference at all. The only difference is that some screeners like VoiceOver, they implement a stop when they reach a block level element. So, you know, it turns out this was wrong. So I had to, you know, remove the div and I think I just added span within span or something like that. I don't remember. So yes, follow the specs of your target language and everything will be good. What are landmarks and how do you declare them? So landmarks are basically like the building blocks of your website, okay? So let's say you have an apartment. Well, I live in an apartment. And every apartment must have, you know, a living room, bedroom, kitchen, bathroom. And the same thing is with the website. So every website must have a header, a footer, main. So basically the main is going to be the living room. And, you know, the footer is going to be probably the door outside. And the header is going to be the bedroom, something like that. So landmarks are like invisible for sighted users, but they're very important for screen readers or other assistive technologies, because screen reader users, just like sighted users, whenever they go to a new website, they like to scan. Some of them, not all of them, some of them like to scan, or some of them like to read it from top to bottom. You know, you don't know how the user likes to browse the web. And if you have separated your website in landmarks, users can jump very quickly with their screen reader from landmark to landmark. Let's say that, for example, someone's dog gets sick, okay? And they have their veterinarian's website saved on their phone, so they open it. So what they want to do is they want to see if the veterinarian is open, okay? And so they open their screen reader and they jump directly into the header. Or, for example, they want to see if their veterinarian conducts surgeries. So they open their screen reader, navigation, and then under navigation, you know, services. They jump into that, yes, their veterinarian conducts surgeries, okay? It's very easy for them to skip. And that's not only for screen readers, it's also for sighted users with browser extensions. And I think in one of my videos, I show you how you can jump from section to section with that extension. So that's pretty cool. One thing I forgot to tell you is that landmarks is actually part of the WGAC. So they're part of 1.3.1 info and relationships. And they're also part of bypass blocks. Okay. So having landmarks technically makes you not forced to provide a skip link, but that's like a whole other conversation. But always have landmarks and a skip link. So yeah, it's in the WGAC and you should take landmarks very seriously. What are the best automated testers and what will they miss that we should look for? That's a really good question. A lot of the testers, I think, they just use Axcore and its core. Lighthouse, Chrome Lighthouse uses Axe. Accessibility Insights from Microsoft uses Axe. If you don't know, Axe is like an engine built by DQ for auditing websites. So my favorite one is, I think, a toss-up between Chrome Lighthouse and Microsoft Accessibility Insights. My printer woke up. So what they miss is, they usually miss like a lot, but things like, for example, language. So if your website is full with jargon talk or abbreviations with no way to expand or see the full name of the abbreviation, you know, those automated testing are going to miss that. Anything that's not explicitly said in the code, they're going to miss it as well. For example, let's say that, you know, you have a model that opens up but the focus doesn't automatically goes into the model. So you have to tap through the end of the page to go into the model. That's horrible user experience. But you know, an automated test is not gonna see that. Usually before I audit the website, I run automated testing, get the errors, put them in my report, and then I start, you know, running the screen readers and see what else they missed, which is a lot. I think I read somewhere that they catch about 30% of issues, which is still a lot, I mean, for what they are able to do. So I think I use them just as a helper, you know. Like, imagine having a food processor in your kitchen. Like, it cannot cook the food, but it's gonna help you cook the food faster, okay? Something like that. I have a site that has a guided menu that activates a step only after you have finished the previous one. In my opinion, it shouldn't be a hamburger menu. Is that correct? I have a site that has a guided menu that activates a step only after you finish the previous. In my opinion, it shouldn't be a hamburger menu, correct? What I think that is like a multi-step form. So yeah, if you have a multi-step form, the next step and the previous step, they shouldn't be hidden behind the hamburger menu. No, that's actually very, very bad. So don't do that. They have to be in big buttons with arrows, with visible labels, very easy for the users to access them. And that comes again, you know, with our automated testing things. They're not gonna see that. So yeah, don't hide them behind the hamburger menu. I have a site that has a table containing a form elements of a form. It's a bit old. I have listened with NVIDIA, and apart from declaring the table, the form listens well, okay? There is a way to leave the table and tell how the blind how to use it. It will be too expensive to remove it from all pages. I don't understand that. I have a site that has a table containing form elements. So if NVIDIA is announcing everything correctly, like the table rows, columns, and it's announcing the inputs correctly, I mean, I think it's fine, as long as, you know, not just NVIDIA, as long as the markup is standard, even if it's old, it's fine. I don't see an issue with that. That's why testing is so important. Okay, another question. Alternative way to do mobile web accessibility testing without real device? Yeah, you can't. If you need to do mobile accessibility testing for other screen readers like VoiceOver, you need an iPhone. Like, I have an iPhone. I don't use it, I only use it for VoiceOver. And also, VoiceOver on iOS is different from VoiceOver on macOS, okay? They're different screen readers. So you can have issues on one and not have issues on the other. But don't just have your website at 320 narrow and then use NVDA to test it, because they're not gonna use NVDA on their phones, okay? You need to have the real devices. Unfortunately, there's no way around that. Details about ADA implementation, radio button, and pop-up models. So the ADA is Americans with Disabilities Act. They referenced the WIG Act 2.0, so they don't actually tell you how to do your site. And how to make a radio button accessible on radio button and pop-up models. So if the radio button makes a model pop-up, what you have to do is you have to warn the user beforehand saying, hey, if you toggle this radio button, a model is gonna pop up, okay? This is part of the WIG Act, so your web pages must be predictable to users, okay? Because how many forms have you gone to where you toggle radio buttons and suddenly a form pops up? Not a lot of them. And even when that happens, I'm actually surprised. I'm like, oh, what's happening now, you know? So yeah, if any time your web page does something that is not very common, you have to make sure you add a warning, or you just don't do it at all, depending how uncommon that is, okay? So, and I think there's another question for testing native apps. So with native apps, some WIGAC success criterions apply and some don't. Something like skip links don't apply. Some, I think iOS or Android don't really have headings. They only have headings to level one, or they just have ambiguous, they just have headings that are the same level. So with that, you basically have to test it and see if it works or not. And you know, you can still apply the WIGAC if you're building an app from scratch, of course. But most of the time you have to do testing, and it is especially mobile, especially user testing, okay? Because there's no WIGAC for like native apps. So you have to really play it by ear, and you have to be really, really knowledgeable about the WIGAC. That's why it's very important. If you want to be an accessibility specialist, yeah, you have to read it. And you have to memorize as much as possible and understand it correctly, because that's even more difficult. But yeah, I think that's everything from the questions. Let me know if you have other questions, and I will make another video, so...
For some reason, my microphone and video cut out here. So yeah, this is the end of the video. Thank you for watching. Don't forget to like and subscribe the video.